Hello gorgeous peeps, this is Chris from Recombu and it's Huawei Mate 20 launch day. I'm here with the Mate 20 Pro. I've just been to the event, picked up my review device, and now we're going to do a full unboxing, get it all set up and have a full run through all of the specs, the software, the EMUI 9 interface, everything you need to know. And of course we'll be bringing you a full Mate 20 Pro, a camera review, tips and tricks and in-depth review as well. So don't forget to hit subscribe and ding that notifications bell so you don't miss out. So the Huawei P20 Pro is one of my favourite smartphones from 2018, so I'm very much excited about checking out the Mate 20 Pro, which continues some of the design language, such as that tri-lens camera tech, and just expands on them, makes it even better. Touch wood. So there is the Mate 20 Pro in all of its glory. Let's just peel off this wrapper. Now this right here is the Twilight model, which quite closely mimics the gorgeous Morpho Aurora version of the P20 Pro. Go check out a full in-depth unboxing of that particular model. Absolutely gorgeous, stunning design. As you can see there, similar sort of finish here. Nice dark shades down here at the bottom of the device. And then as you go up towards the top, it morphs through the sort of twilight purple into a nice clear blue. Lovely stuff. We've seen the launch of a fair few premium smartphones already this past month. Google's Pixel 3 pair, the iPhone XS, and now this bad boy here, the Huawei Mate 20 Pro. This little teaser's been lingering on the horizon for absolutely yonks now. Huawei launched the light version of it over a month ago, the absolute buggers. But the wait for the full-fat Pro version has definitely been worth it. The Mate 20 Pro is already a contender for phone of the year thanks to its smart tech and original features. Here's my full in-depth Mate 20 Pro review after using it as my personal handset for over a week now. And don't forget to hit subscribe and ding that notifications bell for more on the latest and greatest tech. Cheers! So first up, yes, the Mate 20 Pro is a bit of a beast, rocking a mighty 6.4-inch screen. But unlike the standard Mate 20, this Pro model doesn't feel bulky or cumbersome to clutch. That's thanks to those teeny-weeny bezels and the way that that display curves neatly around the edges of the phone, just like on Samsung's flagships. Huawei's design may not exactly scream originality, at least outside of that funky square camera chassis. Even that slick gradient finish has been lifted basically wholesale from the awesome Morpho Aurora P20 Pro. Although you can get it with a new hyper-optical pattern finish if you snaffle the blue or the green models, which is apparently supposed to help with the grip and also the general smudginess, just as well really because the Mate 20 Pro, like all glass smartphones, is a bit of a grease monkey. But even though we've seen it all before, the Mate 20 Pro is still a total stunner. If you're turned off by big blowers, then this phone obviously won't hold much appeal. But if you're resigned to smartphones now being as big as the average house cat, then just feast your eyes. So far, the Mate 20 Pro seems pretty rugged as well, as you'd kind of hope for a premium smartphone. They're not exactly cheap. You don't get a screen protector installed, unfortunately, unlike on the P20 Pro, which made us a little bit nervous, but touch wood, so far, no scratches to speak of. You do get a transparent cover bundled with the Mate 20 Pro, though, if you are super paranoid about dropping the thing. Although we found that the jut and lip at the bottom made Android Pie's gesture controls a little bit tricky to pull off, so it is a bit of a compromise. And of course, the Mate 20 Pro is fully IP68 water resistant as well. Speaking of Android Pie, it's not quite as satisfying to use here on the Huawei Mate 20 Pro as it was on Google's Pixel phones. You lose that quick multitasking functionality seen on the Pixels, which means that you're left with option B, sliding your finger up the screen and then pausing and waiting for your apps menu to pop into life. It's a bit clunky and poo, and that's putting it mildly. I also noticed one quirky little issue where archiving emails through the notifications tab would occasionally take bloody ages for no real reason. Still, those minor complaints aside, everything else works as expected, and the EMUI 9 adds some neat functionality, including plenty of one-handed help as always. You can always bring back that old school navigation dock if you like, and there's loads of motion and gesture support too. Both the Mate 20 and the Mate 20 Pro rock Huawei's own EMUI 9 overlay, which is basically chock full of great bonus features designed to make your life as wonderful as possible. I've used both the Mate 20 and the Mate 20 Pro as my full-time personal handset, and here's my in-depth tips and tricks guide to have you get set up and get the most out of your Mate with the best bonus hidden features and lots more besides. And don't forget, for more on the latest and greatest mobile tech, smash that subscribe button and ding that notifications bell. Cheers! So when you first set up your Mate 20 or your Mate 20 Pro, you will have an immediate problem. No apps drawer down below. This means that all of your apps are cluttered there on your desktops, just looking all bloody horrible and stuff. Fear you not though, because it is quick and easy to fix. All you need to do is go into the settings menu and dive into home screen and wallpaper. In there you'll see an option saying home screen style. Just give that a little tappy tap and then poke this drawer option. The theme will change up, and as you can see, you now have an apps drawer which you can use to hide away all of those apps that you don't want cluttering your desktop's much meter. Lovely stuff. Another handy option is the home screen settings. Just pinch your fingers together on those desktop and you'll get the home screen settings option down below right there. This allows you to change the general grid layout so you can pack even more apps or less apps on there if you desire. You can also get rid of that Google feed, which you can activate by basically swiping right from your main desktops. Some people quite like it. It basically gives you a brief rundown of headlines that you might personally be interested on based on your previous browsing habits and the rest. But if you don't want it, it's quick and easy to shut off. Boom, no more Google feed, nice and simple. Now, when you first get your Mate 20 or Mate 20 Pro set up, chances are you want to copy over your data, your contacts, your messages, all the important shiz from your old phone onto the new one. And that is where Huawei's phone clone feature comes in really handy. You find this in the settings menu right at the bottom. All you need to do is just tap system, and there it is, phone clone. Now, as this is your new phone, you'll obviously select this is the new phone and then choose whatever model your old phone was. So in this case, it is an Android. Now, if you're coming from another Huawei smartphone, then chances are you've already got phone clone installed on it, nice and easy. No worries if not though, you'll be able to download phone clone using the Google Play Store, Apple's App Store, or whatever else your old phone uses. That done, just select this is the old phone on the old phone, nice and easy, and then just scan that QR code. The two smartphones will then connect wirelessly and you'll be able to choose exactly what you want to copy over to the new phone on the old handset. As you can see there, everything from documents, videos, photos, your calendar entries, the whole lot is available to copy. Now, by default, the Mate 20 and the Mate 20 Pro both come with a virtual navigation bar down here below. It just helps you to quickly get back to your desktops from any app. And you can also see your recent apps, and in the case of this one, you can actually pull down that notifications bar as well, which is very handy because both Mate 20 and the Mate 20 Pro are absolute beasts. You can fully customize the navigation dock by going into the settings and then go to system and then go to system navigation. As you can see, that's how you can add in this button to drag down the notifications dock, and you can also change up the general arrangement. However, we actually personally prefer turning on the gestures option instead. This basically allows you to just swipe up from the bottom of the screen in order to get back to the home screen instead. You can also go back with a quick swipe from the edge of the screen. And if you want to bring up your recent apps, just drag from the bottom of the screen and hold, and as you can see, you can then bring up the full recent apps list. Nice and easy. Now, one of the new features added by EMUI version 9 is the digital balance. This is basically a virtual nanny who tells you exactly how much time you've wasted on your smartphone when you should be doing something better with your life, like going around sniffing daffodils or something. You can get a detailed breakdown of exactly what you've been doing if you so desire, and you can also turn on the screen time management feature if you really can't be trusted. Is actually a genuinely useful feature if you're going to be giving your Mate 20 or Mate 20 Pro to a kid, because it can limit their usage, therefore stopping them from browsing Facebook or YouTube well into the wee hours. As you can see, you can set a daily screen time. You can also choose a time frame that you can actually use the smartphone between. And as you can see, at the end of that time, you can just block all apps usage or simply grey the screen entirely. Now, both the Mate 20 and the Mate 20 Pro are really strong when it comes to security. The Mate 20 Pro actually has an in-display fingerprint sensor, which is pretty nifty. And both smartphones support a nice bit of facial recognition as well, which is actually quicker to use than that sensor. To get it all set up, just dive into the settings menu and then, unsurprisingly, go to the security and privacy section. In here, you can hit fingerprint ID to set up the fingerprint or go into face recognition to set up that facial recognition. Who'd have thunk it, eh? All you need to do is tap into that facial recognition section, hit enroll face, and then basically, you just gotta roll your head around in a circle like so, so it can take a proper 3D map of your mug. With that done, you'll then want to hit direct unlock. This just allows you to basically tap the power button, it'll immediately read your face and it'll go straight into your desktops rather than having to slide up the screen in order to unlock it. The only reason you'd want that activated is if you want to check out your notifications on the lock screen before you actually unlock. So as you can see, now just a quick tap of that power button and boom, it recognizes your mug and you're straight into the apps. In the security settings, you'll also find a couple of other helpful features such as the password vault. This just stores all your various passwords for your various online accounts, and then you can actually access your accounts just by using the fingerprint sensor or the facial unlock instead. It's great if your memory sucks as bad as mine. And we also like the file safe as well, which is basically a simple way of encrypting anything of a sensitive nature. Definitely good news if you use your Mate 20 or Mate 20 Pro as a work device, or if you're just generally up to shady things in your spare time. Don't forget as well that you can fully customize the display within those settings as well on both the Mate 20 and the Mate 20 Pro. We highly recommend doing so. So for instance, jump into color and eye comfort mode, you can turn on that eye comfort feature. This just filters the blue light to give a more easy on the eye experience, like so. However, it's best used when you actually schedule it, so you can have it turning on automatically in the evenings, knocking off in the mornings again as well, so you don't even have to think about it. While you're in there, you can also dive into the more display settings, and there's a notch option as well. It's only a tiny little dinky notch here on the Mate 20, but it is a bit more full on the Mate 20 Pro. So if you're really not a fan, you can just basically hide it from view. As you can see, it just masks it with a... just tap hide notch, and as you can see, it just masks it from view with a nice black bar across the top of the screen, nice and easy. Now, as mentioned before, both the Mate 20 and the Mate 20 Pro are rather beastly blowers, but there is more one-handed help as well. All you need to do is swipe up from the corner of the display towards the center from either side, and this shrinks down the display in that direction. You can then, a bit more easily, access that notifications bar, and of course use all of your apps in this format as well. And then when you're done, just tap that black exterior in order to get back to full screen mode. You can set this up by diving into the settings and then head to Smart Assistant. Inside of Smart Assistant, you'll find the one-handed UI feature. All you need to do is activate mini screen view and Bob's your uncle. And lastly, don't forget about Huawei's knuckle gesture mode as well. All you need to do is tap on the screen and drag your knuckle across the screen like so. There we go, we'll get there in the end. And what this does is it splits the screen at that point, and then you can choose another app to open up in the bottom half of the display. As you can see, you can then use both apps at the same time. Lovely stuff. And you can even drag around that middle bar so you can dedicate more of the screen to one app or the other. And when you're done, just drag that bar all the way down to the bottom and the bottom app will disappear. Lovely stuff. Huawei seems to have focused on security with the Mate 20 Pro, which is obviously commendable. You get a choice between that in-screen fingerprint sensor or facial recognition for swiftly unlocking the phone, and both of them work a charm. With a bit of practice, you'll instinctively know where on the screen to tap your thumb. Although the Mate does pop an indicator on at the screen anyway when the Mate detects that it's been picked up. You have to press firmly for the sensor to work, but it does the job, even when your finger is a little bit damp. Alternatively, you do get some very accurate and very responsive facial recognition, which works perfectly at any angle, even in low light. So what about that 6.4-inch OLED display then? Well, if you want a smartphone for watching shows on your commute, you really can't go wrong. Visuals are pleasingly punchy, while that display is spacious and sharp enough to make out every tiny fine detail when kicking back with a bit of Netflix. At the time of shooting this review though, the Mate 20 Pro didn't support HDR streaming on that particular app, but hopefully that'll change very shortly. As usual with Huawei phones, you can dial down the vibrant visuals and fiddle with the color temperature, and you also get the standard night mode shenanigans as expected. You get a decent pair of speakers here on the Mate 20 Pro as well. They're not quite as powerful as the ones on the Pixel 3, but they definitely do the job when watching a bit of YouTube in a noisy environment or whatever. But also, as with the Pixels, you do not get any support for 3.5mm headphones. Boo. As for the storage, it's 128 gigs as standard, and it does support memory cards, but unfortunately they're Huawei's new proprietary nano memory cards, not standard micro SD. Definitely a rather bold or perhaps ill-advised move considering how well Sony's memory sticks went down. So on to performance, and the Mate 20 Pro slays in that area as well. We didn't see the odd strange little stammer such as that notifications archiving issue, but everyday running is solid. Every kind of game we threw at the phone worked perfectly, partly thanks to that meaty Kirin 980 chipset backed by 6 gigs of RAM, and also partly because of the GPU Turbo Smarts, which helped to keep a consistent frame rate on the likes of PUBG and Vainglory. And that big old display is a great way to take down your foes from afar. Battery life is even better. The Mate 20 Pro packs in a 4200mAh cell, and you'll easily make it through a full day even with pretty much constant use. That includes plenty of camera and Skype action too. You can then charge up the phone in impressively little time thanks to the new supercharge support, which has been boosted to 40 watts. And there's also support for wireless charging too, if that's your bag. And yes, that reverse wireless charging works absolutely fine too, so you can power up your buddies in an emergency and generally be an all-round bloody hero. As for that camera tech, you once again get a tri-lens setup just like on the P20 Pro, but it's changed up a bit. So you get that standard 40 megapixel primary lens, you still get that 8 megapixel telephoto lens, but you also now get a secondary super wide angle lens, which is a 20 megapixel effort. That means you get even greater flexibility here on the Mate 20 Pro for the snap-in smarts than you did on that P20 Pro. Like the P20 Pro before it, Huawei's mighty Mate 20 Pro rocks a tri-lens rear camera, except now it's arranged in this funky sort of square configuration thing. You once again have a 40 megapixel primary lens with an f1.8 aperture, except this time around with the Mate 20 Pro, it's backed by a 20 megapixel ultra wide angle lens with an f2.2 aperture to help give you a different view of the world. And of course, you still get that funky 8 megapixel telephoto lens with a bit of built-in optical image stabilization to give you nice sharp shots, even at a distance. I've been testing out the Huawei Mate 20 Pro's camera tech for a few days now, and here is my in-depth review along with lots of photo and video goodness. Now, a full Mate 20 Pro review will be coming soon, so don't forget to hit subscribe and ding that notifications bell to be the first to know. Cheers! First of all, boot up the Huawei camera app, and it's no surprises there, certainly if you've used the P20 Pro or any recent Huawei smartphones. As usual, you can flip around between the various camera modes down here below, or just tap the one you want. It's nice and quick and convenient. Well, as usual, Master AI scene recognition is on board. Loves to bring drab photos to life, but at any point you can knock it off. And as usual, you've got full manual controls as well if you know what you're doing. So once again, you can tweak the color output, the ISO level, shutter speed, everything you need to get a very precise output. So unsurprisingly, our everyday shots were simply sublime. You get buckets of detail crammed into every snap, especially when you bump up to that rather crazy 40 megapixel setting. Well, with Master AI, once again crafts some seriously vibrant photos. They're not realistic looking images by any stretch, but they really shine when they're viewed on a digital screen. Boring shots of buildings suddenly look rich and fully textured, while those natural scenes are brought to life with a nice little boost. And thankfully, Huawei has tempered the effect when snapping any naturally punchy, vivid subjects, so the result isn't too sickly sweet. Of course, you also have the option to completely control the colour output if you want more accurate photos, so the Mate 20 Pro should suit all kinds of tastes. Occasionally, this phone does still struggle a bit in those dynamic scenes with dark and light elements. Take shots on a bright day and you'll see the odd spot of oversaturation, for instance, although it's certainly not a serious problem, certainly not to the point where you'd actually chuck away any of those snaps. And for the most part, the Mate 20 Pro can deal with those brighter elements without losing much detail in the darker bits. But it's the flexibility that the Huawei Mate 20 Pro offers that really impresses us. That ultra-wide-angle lens comes in really handy when you want to grab a touristy vista shot, while standing on the exact same spot, you can zoom right into a piece of architecture or some finer detailing that really catches your eye. As you can see here, it's stunning stuff. Those low-light shots certainly aren't a problem either, thanks to Huawei's brilliant night mode. This takes a long exposure shot with ridiculously crisp results, no tripods or bonus equipment required. You get very little grain, and those colours really come through stronger than we expected as well. Awesome stuff. Portrait results are, as on the P20 Pro before it, both accurate and attractive. With the Mate 20 Pro, the subject always appears sharp, even in action shots, while the background is nicely washed out. And you've got all kinds of different settings to play with here, all of which change up the final look of your photo. For instance, you can swirl the background or turn it into blurry hearts, or even make it look like you're in some funky disco all on your lonesome, if that's your bag. The effects are actually well implemented, although we're not entirely sure when you'd ever want to use most of them, unless you want to take a photo where it looks like you're spying on your neighbours through your blinds. And as usual, those spotlight effects are a bit ropey, failing to clearly define your subject's silhouette more often than not. When it comes to the video results, they are absolutely lovely. Nothing much has changed here on the Mate 20 Pro compared with the P20 Pro, so you can once again capture full HD footage at 30 or 60 frames per second, or boost up to 4K for pin-sharp playback. At that 60fps level, the focus is a bit soft, but there's no such problems at the other settings, and that 4K resolution footage looks effing marvellous. Although I did notice a peculiar warping of the image at times towards the very edge of one side of the screen. Hopefully that's just some weird glitch that'll be ironed out in a future update. Huawei has really improved the image stabilization for that Ultra HD setting as well, so finally you can move around and shoot video without a pukerific shaky result. Hooray! And yes, you can also record your surroundings with that ultra-wide-angle lens for suitably funky results. So in verdict, the Mate 20 Pro is frankly shit toss. It's not quite perfect, the software experience is still a little bit gammy here and there, but a couple of little tweaks, couple of little bug fixes, and hopefully it'll do the job nicely. Certainly can't fault the Mate 20 Pro when it comes to performance, battery life, display tech, anything like that. It all works perfectly. And security isn't an issue either, with that brilliant in-screen fingerprint sensor and the fantastic facial recognition. And all that smart is wrapped up in a frankly gorgeous package that we can't get enough of. Of course, there is still one little wild card that could rock Huawei's boat, and that is the OnePlus 6T. The new OnePlus phone is set to launch on October the 29th. We'll be bringing you our full hands-on coverage on that day, so definitely stay tuned. Please let us know what you think of the Huawei Mate 20 Pro down below. Is it the best phone of 2018? Definitely be great to hear your thoughts, and will the OnePlus 6T beat it when it comes out? Well, we'll have to wait and see about that. Don't forget to hit subscribe, ding that notifications bell, and as always, love you, bye.